Okay, welcome back to RoboCup at Home Education Online Classroom. So, and welcome to all the newcomers. So today we have this invited lecture series, which is we have this special session for our last guest from our online session, online challenge 2020. So today we have this team from France, RoboBreizh, and the title is Design of a Modular Architecture Using ROS, the Pepper Case. Okay, so I will start with a brief introduction on this session, then later on I'll proceed with introduce the team. Okay, so this is the arrangement for today's session. So we will start at 3 p.m. over there in France time, and also 9 p.m. over here in GMT 8, and also morning in New York time. Right, and I'm Jeffrey from RoboCup at Home Education. So I'll be again the host for today's session. So please, if you have any question, please send it to me. You can message me or you can send email and anything so that we can actually gather all the question and we will have the Q&A session at the end of the presentation. Right, and today it's our honor to invite RoboBreizh from Lab-STICC, ENIB, from France, okay? And for all the details, if you would like to know more about this session and also more detail about our guest today, please head on to our website, which is the link is over there. You can get more details on today's session and also this whole program. Right, so as privacy reminder, I would like to remind everyone that video will be recorded and this video will be published later on online on our YouTube channel and also other social media. So please, for the rest of the guests, whoever audience that is not presenting, please refrain from turn on your webcam and also turn on your speaker mic. You can do so later on in Q&A when we will invite you if you would like to ask some question to our guests, right? Okay, so please allow me about 1-2 minutes to introduce RoboCup at Home Education, just in case any new comer or any new audience that just joined in this session. So RoboCup at Home Education is an educational initiative in RoboCup at Home, which is in RoboCup, that promotes educational effort to boost our participation and artificial intelligence focused service robot development. So under this initiative, currently we are running four main operation. So the first one is we organize RoboCup at Home Education Challenge, which is in previous year, we organized this challenge within a national level, regional level, and also international level. International level, it will be run parallel with the RoboCup event, right? Then the second effort is we try to gather all our resources in order to help our especially beginner team to start AI learning and also service robot development. So this is under this open source educational robot platform resources that open for everyone. Okay, but with just the resources, it might be not so friendly for especially for people that is new or non-technical person and even general public that wish to know about AI and also know more about service robot development. Hence, in this initiative, we have started effort in open course software the development, where we try to develop teaching materials based on our resources from the open source development materials. So with this open courseware, we actually run a lot of workshops and also talks, and also this material will be used in many educational institution within our community that they can use these materials for teaching and also learning, right? And lastly, we actually did a lot of outreach program, especially hands-on program that we have workshops and also introductory talks and so on that run throughout the whole world, which is we have run in many schools and also university. So out there, for any of you who are interested to know more about our content and also our teaching materials, our learning materials that you would like to share in your community, feel free to talk to us, and we will see how we can actually outreach our program and also our resources to your community. All right, so for more information, please head to our website with over there. And if you would like to interact with us, feel free to like and also join our Facebook group. So over there is our Facebook page. Within the page, we have actually a group that you can join and interact with all our community, our committee member, and also the teams that join in our activities. Okay, so lastly, on behalf of RoboCup at Home Education, I would like to say thanks and also appreciate all the support from our sponsor. So over here we have RoboCup, Masswork, SoftBank Robotics, Jupiter Robots, and also IEEE RS. Right, so today we are running this special invited lecture series under our RoboCup at Home Education online classroom. And we have actually run about 10 classes before this that we specially invite winners and also experts from our previous online challenge 2020. So we invite the teams that using this platform to actually introduce some new techniques or new development and share some knowledge to our community, and also for that this session is also open for general public. And apart from this invited lecture series, we also have regular online classes track, which is we have done previously earlier this year, that all the videos and also slides are available on our website. And also for the previous online challenge 2020, we have gathered a large amount of learning resources in standard platform and also open platform under this special online challenge track. So feel free to head to our website to know to access more on this learning materials. Okay, so those are the introduction about RoboCup at Home and what this session is all about. So I would like to invite our guest today, which is RoboBreizh from France, and let me briefly introduce them first. Okay, so RoboBreizh is a project of the Rombo team of Lab-STICC, located at the European Center of Virtual Reality, CERV, of the National Engineering School of Brest. And it was launched in 2019, okay, by Cedric Bruch, a full professor at ENIB. And the current goal of this project is to create a team to be part of the RoboCup 2021 products edition. So this is just a very brief, so I will pass this session to the team and let them introduce more about themselves and also start their technical presentation for today. Right, so for team, so I will pass the screen to you and you can proceed from there.
Okay, thank you so much, Jeffrey. It's my great pleasure to be here to introduce my team. So the name of the team is RoboBreizh. We are French. And today the presentation will be about how to design a modular approach using Rust. And as said before, we'll talk about a paper today. So we are a small team. I'm full professor. Amélie and Antoine are PhD students, and we have also two undergraduate students. We are Maïlik and Cédric. So, as you know, we were part of the RoboCup at Home Education Online Challenge. It's a good start because the idea will be to be selected for the RoboCup at Home competition in Bordeaux. So as you can see on the photo, the picture, we have more robots than humans. So today we have four papers and around 15 now. So we have two teams. One is RoboCup Atom, and the other one is RoboCup Soccer. So now playing soccer. It was the introduction. I will pass my turn to Malik, and he will explain how we design our code to win this challenge.
So, hello everyone, my name is Malik, and I will talk a little bit about architecture design, especially for robotics project. So the goal of this part is to describe how we implement our solution for the RoboCup Atom Education Challenge. So first, when you need to create an architecture for robotics, and especially for a competition like RoboCup Atom, you need to fully understand what is the required capabilities that your robot need for the competition. So for this step, we mostly analyze the rules and the previous competition to come up with a list of capabilities. So here you can see some example, like for recognition and action that the robot should perform. This is important in this part to analyze also the environment in which the robot will evolve. For example, the kind of object that will be present, the size of the room, and all this stuff to fully describe each capabilities. Next step is to think about how you will be able to implement these capabilities in your solution. So here, the main approach is to divide them into modules that we call functionalities. So these have some advantages. The first one is that you can split easily the work on your team members. For example, each one will develop a specific modules. Another advantage is that you can easily remove or add functionalities on your application. So on the picture, you can see some modules that you can have in this kind of competition, for example, vision, navigation, movement, and communication. Next, I will show you what modules to choose to implement for the RoboCup Atom Education Challenge. So we keep the main one, perception, navigation, interaction, and movement. But as you can see on this diagram, they are not connected between us, but with a fifth one, which we called manager. So the main role of manager is to rules the other modules and call them when necessary in our final scenario. Here you can see another diagram that explains a little bit more about communication between all the modules and how they will interact with the managers. So the idea is to think about at what time you will need to call each capabilities and how that will be called, for example, synchronously or asynchronously, if the manager will stop before getting the robot's response of an action or not, basically, and if there is also capabilities that don't need to be called directly by the manager but by another module. And the final step is to think about how you will implement those capabilities on the hardware. So basically, the paper hardware is very low computational resources. So you need to think another solution to implement all your code. So our solution was to mainly develop all the code on external computers. So we have one computer that rules all the main modules like navigation, movement, interaction, and the manager. This computer communicates with the paper robot using ROS for Robot Operating System. This is a framework that able to communicate easily with the robot. We will talk a little bit more after about ROS. And finally, we got another computer when we have the perception module. So the idea was to let the perception module on another computer because it is intensive in resources, because we use like deep neural networks and we need a big GPU, and this can be hard to compute in the same computer. So now that you have your architecture, you can start programming, and I will let a little bit more Antoine talk about this step.
Okay, so hello everyone. So originally the project started during the COVID lockdown in France, and our lab was closed and it wasn't possible for us to use the paper robot. So it was therefore necessary to find a way to work without having access to paper. So as such, initial development were carried out on a simulator, which is Quibulet. It's a simulator that you can see on the screen. Compared to other simulators, the main advantage of Quibulet is that paper modelization is faithful to the reality. That means that sensors are correctly modelized. And it was possible to develop an architecture for the simulated robot, which also be usable on an actual one. This allows us to grasp the advantage and disadvantage of using a simulation software in context of robotic development. So mainly, everyone can test their own development, because we developed one of us developed one module, and we can test these developments from our workstation without requiring the physical robot, and we can test this on the simulator. So performing these tests on Quibulet has many advantages. That means that we don't need the real robot to perform tests, as I said. There is no breakage in case of bugs. It's a cheaper way to develop, and it's possible to run as many simulations as desired. But developments on simulator also have a disadvantage and a main disadvantage, which is that some bugs can only be encountered while using a real robot. And so it's very useful to develop a prototype and initial architecture and algorithm on the simulator, but tests on the physical robot shouldn't be neglected at all. Moreover, in the artificial intelligence field, it's common to train an agent, which can be a robot, for example, using multiple simulations run in parallel. Using a simulator is a really good idea, and Quibulet is a good simulator to simulate a paper. So now we will present you a quick presentation about ROS and our developed architecture, which is contained in the ROS environment.
Hi everyone, so I will present some ROS basic. So this part is more for the beginner, so if you are not beginner, you can skip this part. So ROS is a standard framework. Next slide, please. The advantage of ROS is that you can control every robot in the same way, because when you want to program a robot, you need to learn the native API of the robot and everything. But if you want to program different robots, a good idea to do that is to use ROS. ROS means Robot Operating System. ROS was created by Euro Garage in 2007. And this is an open-ended framework, so everyone can use it and add things on this framework and understand how this works. ROS is compatible with lots of robots, over 150 robots. And lots of packages are available online to start with, and you can share some package with a large community who can help you if you have some question or if you want to understand a few things. Lots of robots are available with ROS. So for example, you can see some picture of four robots. So from left to right, there is the the total robot, the HSR, paper, and now robot. This picture is the communication infrastructure of ROS. So if you want to learn ROS, you need to understand how the communication work. So there is a ROS master who manage everything. Each package have one or multiple nodes, and the communication between nodes work with service and topics. So everything, message, node, and everything are standardized. So if you want to learn ROS, you need to understand this communication. And to do that, there is an online tutorial to start with and understand everything. ROS is available with lots of tools. So for example, you can use RVs. RVs is a 3D visualization of sensor of your robot. So if you want to see what the robot can see with his sensors, you can use these tools. So for example, with the paper, you can see the sonar, laser, infrared, and also the camera. So with this visualization, it's more understandable to see what the robot understand of the environment. ROS, so for a conclusion of the ROS, this is an open source framework and a standard framework for multiple robots. So you can use it with lots of available packages, and a large community can help you, and you can start with some tutorials. But there is some disadvantage with ROS. So for example, sometimes native API of robots give more possibilities than packages from ROS. And maybe it can be hard to understand for beginner in computer science also. And ROS works with an asynchronous communication. So if you have a sequential scenario, it can be hard to follow it step by step. Now that we have explained the architecture design and the ROS basic, we will explain you our proposal for the RoboCup at Home Education Online Challenge, and we will explain each module that we have developed. So let's begin with the manager package.
Okay, so the primary functions of our robot, such as vision, dialogue, movement, and navigation, are created in independent modules. These modules are divided into two parts, like passive modules and active modules. I mean the passive modules, such as vision, retrieve information using the robot sensors, and active modules, such as the navigation, for example, execute orders. In order to connect all modules together and achieve the correct behavior in a given situation, we set a central module, which is the manager module, that contains the scenario. So this module is the only link between all the others, and the manager sends order to active modules, like navigation, in response to information from passive modules. For example, if you want to start a dialogue with someone, the robot first has to detect the person, and the manager starts calling the vision module and stores the result of the vision, if someone is in front of the robot or not. And if a human is detected, the manager sends an order to the dialogue module to initiate the discussion. The manager is a high-level structure. That means that when someone or an object is detected, the result is stored in a Python class, because we code the manager in Python, so that it may be used later if necessary. And that's the same for a chair, for example, or any object like that. So the manager also handles task priority. And that means that when a task is more important than another and it needs to be executed earlier, the manager gives a priority to this task. And this architecture was... Yes. Was I muted? Okay. So I will repeat if I miss something.
we missed the entire slide.
From which part do you hear about the high-level structures from the manager?
No.
Okay, sorry about that. I will explain it again. So the manager is, as I said, but you didn't hear it, is the high-level structures. That means that when someone is detected in front of the robot, the object or the person is stored in a Python class because the manager is coded in Python, so that it may be used later if necessary. And the manager also handles task priorities and execute task in the required order. That means that if a task is more important than another and need to be executed in time, the manager handle it. So the manager contains the scenario, and this architecture was designed to quickly design a new behavior. So a new behavior can be implemented without editing any external modules, and only the manager needs to be edited, which is for us a great way to develop the manager. During the competition, this allowed us to quickly create four different scenarios, and a new scenario is really simple to make and use. In order to bypass execution bugs, orders are cancelled if they take too long to execute. That means that the scenario continues before stopping if something doesn't work. Even if this manager isn't a state machine and is a step-by-step algorithm and is not fully developed yet, it correctly answers to our need for the competition requirement. And we quickly, as I said, edit new behavior and scenarios. And that was a great manager for us, but there is a lot of work to do to achieve a great manager. So now we will present you the different developed module as perception, movement, and interactions. Sorry. And we'll start by the perception module.
I'm Cedric Lebono, and in this part I will cover the base-burst perception module. So as you can guess, being able to see and analyze the environment is vital for paper or any kind of robot to actually identify objects and interact with them. So this section was built not only to show how we programmed the vision aspect, but also highlight what the thought process was, so what what was the thought process to develop everything. So we'll start with a brief introduction to computer vision. So the main idea of computer vision is to mimic the way human perceives objects in their environment. So nowadays, this is primarily tackled using neural networks approaches. So to keep it simple, those neural networks are trained to detect several kinds of objects and locate them in images, like in the picture below, for example. So the way it works, briefly, is that the neural networks take the image as an input, take the pixels in the image, extract the color and patterns, and based on the color patterns in an object, there are features extracted. So features are patterns which are unique to certain objects. So to keep it simple, we could say that the nose of a dog is a feature. The same way the wheel of the bike is a feature, etc., etc. So based on these features, the programs then deduce what kind of object is present in an image and its position approximately. Next slide. So now that I've finished to shortly present computer vision, my idea is to ask ourselves, well, now that we know how computer vision works, well, what can we do in the context of the RoboCup? Well, since the goal is to develop a robot which can interact with objects, it would be great if we could detect them. Likewise, we want to detect persons, so we need to be able to detect humans. Additionally, for us, it was deemed interesting enough to detect when a person needs help, So for example, if we as a the person need help to carry his bag, his luggage, etc. So this could be done in several ways. So the idea here was to use a vision aspect and use a vision module to detect if a person is raising his head. So next slide. So now that we know what we want, it is time to see what exists exactly. So as we'll start with object and person detections, there exist different family of solutions. So here's an example where we have an image including a water bottle and a few cups. So here are highlighted a few methods which exist to detect objects, which are more or less which give more or less details. So the most common one is usually the one on the top right, which is called object localization. So the main idea is to localize objects and put them in boxes. The advantage of this method is that it is extremely fast. However, it has a few drawbacks. So the main one is that it has a lot, since it's a box, well, the objects which are detected also include a lot of the background. So it was a problem for us because in our navigation module, which we'll talk afterwards, it was necessary to measure the distance to between the robot and an object using a depth scale mirror. And to do so, we first phase ourselves using the boxes. And the problem that we had is, well, since we had a lot of background inside the boxes, the distance was not measured accurately. So what happened is that most of the time when the paper was detecting a share, it was also detecting a lot of the wall behind it. And therefore, when trying to go towards a share, it will go straight into the share and sometimes just go towards the wall, which is, of course, not a good idea. So the question was, well, how can we remove this problem? So we studied for other kinds of solution, and eventually we used a solution which is called Masker CNN, which uses the one on the bottom right. So as you can see, it's much more accurate. We have pixel perfect localization. The slight drawback of this approach compared to state-of-the-art object localization approaches, such as YOLO V3, is that it is a lot slower. So next slide, please. So now that we've covered object and person detections, the question is, well, how can we detect a person raising his hand? Fortunately for us, there exist algorithms which are called perform pose estimation. So the main idea behind pose estimation is to detect the body and joints of persons, so such as elbows, wrists, fingers, eyes, ears, etc., etc. And to highlight how it works, I will play a short video. So here's a result of the pose estimation module called Open Pose that we use. So as you can see, it is able to detect fairly accurately a person's pose in real time. So here we only focused on a few key points, such as the elbows and the wrist. And as you can see, it can also track movement pretty well. It can track several poses pretty well. And it also works if we're approaching or if we're far away from the camera. So now that we've analyzed what is the state of the art, we've also analyzed a few constraints. So first of all, we have a method which is called Masker CNN, which performs pixel perfect localization of object, which is quite computer intensive. And we have a software, we have a program which also identifies the pose of person in image. Both of them are quite computer intensive, they require a powerful GPU. And so the question is, what can be performed in real time for us? Is the performance satisfying enough? And another problem that we have is, well, the paper's camera has a poor resolution. Is the image quality good enough to extract the information we need? And to do so, well, we need to test everything. And we test it incrementally. So we tested it incrementally. So we first tested pose estimation alone, then object localization alone, then we tested both together, then we tested with different size of objects, well, different camera to see if we could detect with low pixel, with low quality of image. And fortunately for us, with a lot of trial and errors, fortunately for us, it worked correctly. So there is a video showing the results that we obtained. So as you can see, we can very accurately detect a person pose and his localization very accurately in the image with high certainty as well. And as you can see in the background, we can fairly accurately detect the chair as well, even though there is a person in front of it. Oh. And yes, the person can still be detected even with slight pose modification and at multiple distances. And that's it, next slide. So overall, our paper was able to detect object, person, and their poses. So the problem is that it required a very powerful GPU, and because we put everything on another computer, the problem is that it added a slight bit of latency because, well, the distant computer had to we had to recover the data from the paper, which talked to the manager, which talked to another computer, so it added a bit of lag. So overall, we're quite satisfied with our computer vision aspect, but it can still be improved. So in the next section, we'll talk about this thing which I mentioned briefly in the perception module, which is a navigation module, which uses what we have in the perception module. So thank you for watching. If you have any questions, feel free to ask.
So now we'll talk a little bit more about navigation. So first, I will describe the main idea about navigation in robotics. So navigation can be described upon three main parts. Firstly, there is the environment representation. So this part is how the robot will represent itself, the environment in which it evolves in real time. So the main approach for environment representation is mapping, because we work in most cases in non-environment, we can map it beforehand and the robot needs to localize into this map. This is the second part, the real-time localization. And the third part is to find a path to a goal and achieve it. So now that I talk about the idea of navigation, what was the main requirement for the atom education challenge? The only requirement was to navigate to a given goal, but because we are working in a non-environment, we can only deal with non-obstacles. And the last thing that we want was easy to use and fast implementation algorithm, because we are running out of time. So with this requirement, what is the main approach using ROS? So the main approach in navigation using ROS and other tools is simultaneous localization and mapping, called SLAM. There is two different type of SLAM. The idea behind is to perform localization and mapping in the same time to get a 2D or 3D representation of the world and then perform pathfinding in this 2D or 3D map. So on the left, you can see a short video about visual SLAM that use DEF and RGBD camera of the robot to get a 3D representation of the environment. And on the right, you can see the 2D SLAM that use only the LIDAR of the robot, so mostly lasers and sonar. And with this representation, you can only have the grown obstacles. So now that you know the main approach that you can use, what was the constraint of the paper robot? So mostly there is two main constraints. The first one, like said before by Cedric, was the inaccuracy of paper camera. So as you can see on the left pictures, paper is looking to a plain wall, to a flat wall, sorry, but the visualization of the wall is not even flat, so you have to take care of it. Another constraint was the number and range of laser. Basically, paper gets 12 lasers and some sonars, but their range of the laser are about 3.5 meters. So if you want to detect an obstacle beyond this range, you will not be able to. So when performing localization, you must be aware of this range. So what we choose to implement with paper was the LiDAR baseline, so the 2D approach, because we do not care about the 3D representation of the environment, because we have mostly ground obstacles in the arena. So we used the gmapping ROS node to map the environment using LiDAR, and then we used the ROS navigation stack with AMCL, Adaptive Monte Carlo Localization Algorithm, and MoveBase, that is a package that performs pathfinding. So here you can see the result of our implementation in real time. So this is the RVIS visualization. You can see that the white points are the obstacles detected by paper in real time, and all the black and white is the map, and in green you can see the path that the robot have computed. And next you can see the same path performed in real time. So to conclude, we can say that this module was, as we expected, easy to use and fast to implement, and it worked well with short paths and few obstacles. But because of the inaccuracy of dev camera, it can sometimes lead to failure when there is a lot of obstacles. And the last point that we saw that it was sometimes when there is people moving around the robot, it will detect them like obstacles, but because they are not mapped before, it can lead the pathfinding to failure. Now, for the next part, we'll talk a little bit about movement and how paper interact with its surroundings. Thank you.
So the robotic movement allow a robot to move his arm and head and body in the environment and interact with a human. So the main idea is to take object for the interaction in the environment and move his arm and body when you want to create a natural interaction with a human. For the competition, there is some requirement. We need to make the robot do some specific movements. So for example, the robot should take a tiny object or point and empty seat. So to do that, there is different possibilities. So we use the NoQI pose package from ROS. But you can also use the NoQI motion, so this is the native API of the robot, or you can use the MoveIt package from ROS, which allows a planification of movement. And we also want the robot able to learn the movement, not only by defining some pose to define an anterior movement, but we want that the robot learn the entire movement when we show him by moving his arm. So to do that, we need a learning algorithm, and we choose to use the GMM and GMR algorithms. So GMM is Gaussian mixture model and GMR Gaussian mixture regression. So the GMM create a Gaussian from demonstration, and after that the GMM generate the trajectory from Gaussian from the GMM. So we have some constraints with the robot. Because paper cannot take heavy objects, so only light objects, and he's not able to do lots of movements because he had some limitation with his motors, and we also want that the learning movement is easily to do. So this is the learning movement process. So the two first part was previously developed, and the last one was developed for the Atom Education Challenge. So at the beginning, someone moved the robot's arm and head to do some demonstration of the movement. And after one or multiple demonstrations, there is the learning phase who understand what the human wants the robot to do. And after that, the generated trajectory was saved, and this trajectory was read by the movement phase, so the developed package for the competition. So the two first parts was done online, and the last one offline, and the last one was done online. So we don't lose a lot of time to do the algorithm part. So now that you understand the process, you can see some videos. So the first one on the left is the video to show you the demonstration. So you manually move the robot arm and show it the movement. And after that, on the right video, you can see what the robot has learned. So he's able to take the bag. This module work with new movements, so you can easily learn new movements by only showing the movement with the robot, and you can interact with objects, but for now there is no link with perception module, so the robot is not able to adapt the trajectory to new object position or with obstacle. But this part will be done later to be able to move and be adapted to new object position and obstacle. So this is the movement module, and now we will talk about the interaction module, which allows the robot to interact with someone.
Okay, hi again. I'm gonna try to not mute myself this time. So about the interaction module. It's a human-robot interaction called HRI, and those interactions are split into two parts. There is verbal communication, like a dialogue, and unverbal or non-verbal interaction, like a tablet, LEDs, and gestures from the robot. So the competition requirement about interaction was that Pepper can understand the human speech, the intentions of this human, answer to this one, memorize information, and be able to have a natural interaction with the human using nonverbal communication. So the different steps of verbal communication, basically, for a robot is first to perform a speech to text to listen to the human and store the discussion somewhere. Then a natural language processing algorithm is performed, which is an NLP algorithm, and to understand the human's sentence and understand the dialogue. And the final step is a text-to-speech step to answer to the human. So the most important part of this process is the natural language processing part. There are two major technologies about that. There is a rule-based approach, like NLQI or NLTK for Natural Language Toolkit. Or the second approach is a neural network approach, like MBOT, which is trained on a RoboCup atom requirement database, which something like take back orders, for example. On the other side, we use the rule-based approach NeoQI. About non-verbal interaction, paper at the tablet that can be used to display information, show image or video. Paper had multiple LEDs to show its emotion or give a feedback about its state, and can perform gestures to communicate with arm, heads, and body, and his body, her body. I mean. We use these non-verbal communication tools, and we use a tablet to welcome guests. LEDs as a feedback for us. For example, when the paper saw a human, his eyes become red or green for a chair. Something like that, and we use gestures from NeoQI to make paper more alive. Here is a list of the different color using to us to have a feedback about the paper state. Okay, so this interaction module is easy to implement, and if the interaction is predefined. But it's still complex with a human natural language, because gestures are not even for human natural movements accompanying dialogue. So it was not easy for us to define gestures to go with a dialogue or something for paper. So now we're going to show you the video of the final competition. To show you the rendering of our work on the real robots. And to do that, we were gonna switch the sharing screen because I don't have sound on my side.
Hello, everyone. I am Pepper from RoboBreizh team. I am a crew at RoboBreizh Hotel. The demonstration will begin soon.
So first of all, Pepe will try to see if there is someone in the room. So to do so, using algorithms such as MaskRCNN to detect if there are people in the room. Once Pepe has detected someone, it will move towards a person.
Hi, Pepper. I want a room for one night.
I will ask if the room is available. What is your name?
My name is John.
Nice to meet you, John. I will guide you to a seat. Please follow me.
So the next step, Pepper will try to localize himself in the environment, see if there is any chair, and once he has found one, he will find a path towards it and go to its destination. So now he's trying to localize himself. So to do so, we're using the laser sensors from paper, and we use 2D mapping to actually, well, we have a map predefined. So paper will try to localize himself in the map using the obstacles, for example. And once he has
localized, can you see here if he wants? Would you like a drink?
Yes, I would like a Coke, please.
I'd like Coke too.
So the next step, Pepper will move back to its original position, and he will talk to the chief of the hotel and tell him that John has arrived and that he would like a Coke. is orienting himself towards the boss.
Chief, Sir John would like a room for one night. Could you bring him a cloak, please? He is about 25 years old.
As far as age is concerned, we're using a YOLO V3 neural network to determine the age of the person, which is why he was able to say 25 to the manager and give the features of the person. So right now, Paper will try to see if there is someone raising his hand in their environment. So to do so, we're using OpenPause. Now the Paper is detecting someone is moving towards a person. Now he's trying to localize himself.
So as you can see, sometimes the robot takes time for the navigation, so that's why we need to improve this part. So this is in real time.
It's almost done. Just a few more steps.
What can I do for you?
Could you call the taxi, please?
Yes, sure.
Is for the paper robot to take the bag of the person. To do so, it will slowly raise his hand. So in order to teach paper to do this movement, we use GMM and GMR algorithms, so respectively Gaussian mixer module and Gaussian mixer regression. So the goal of this algorithm is to show paper movements, and paper will learn the movements through demonstration. So now that he has a bag, he will move back to his original position, and this will be the end of the demonstration.
Okay. I hope you can benefit from this video, and as you can see, the RoboCup Atom education challenge is a nice application to test all the modules we made. So now it's time for conclusion. So using this application, we were able to define needs, and as you have seen just before, a good idea was to define models. And for that, we use ROS. Using modules, it's a nice solution because it's very flexible. So it was also quite efficient because the team won the performance awards. So next, what we can do? we need to improve the dialogue part. We also need to put everything on board. For example, the vision part was not on board, and we need to do that for the RoboCup Atom competition in Bordeaux. As you already can see, the navigation is okay, but it's quite slow, so we need to improve this system. And maybe at the end, we can participate to the RoboCup Atom competition. So we need to thanks all partners we had So as you can see, we got a lot of funding from company Asterval, but also from academy like ANR, CNRS, the city of Brest, the Brittany region, and we also got some money from Australia. Thank you so much, everybody. I hope it was nice for you. And if you have questions, we will be able to reply. Thank you so much, Jeffrey. It's for you.
Right. Thank you. Thank you for the very interesting presentation, I would say. Okay. So let's invite everyone back. Okay. So we so I have gathered some questions, so we can proceed to the Q&A. So the question will be like, maybe involve different module that all of you just presented. So first question is like, I would like to ask one more general question. Is like, you have developed a ROS framework for controlling Pebble, and you explain the logic, and also you have explained some of the detail. I would like to know, like, do you create this ROS framework specially for Pebble, or actually before you implement in Pebble, you actually try to create a general ROS framework that eventually it can be worked with any kind of robots?
So we develop our program with ROS because it's an easy way to control the robot. But if we want to use not the ROS package but the native API, we can do that. So we develop the package with the ROS architecture and etc. But we can convert it to our own code. So we can not use ROS if we want.
Yes, I understand. But do you actually have plan to use your framework with other robot as well? For example,
actually,
or any other.
Yeah. Actually, there is a movement part that was also tested with now robots, mm-hmm. and we have planned to do so with other modules as well, but we have not done that yet.
Okay. Right.
Yeah,
so,
yeah, I can also say we have mm-hmm. several robots in the lab. We have some Naos, your Yumi, and so on. And we used to play with ROS mm-hmm. because it's very useful when you want to switch from one robot to another one. So we used to play with ROS, and it was not special for this contest.
Okay, I understand. So because like the why I ask this question is like, I assume like you are using Pebble version 2.5, right?
Correct.
The version that you have. Because when I'm working with SoftBank, one direction that they are focused on currently is like, if you upgrade your robot to version 2.9, which is a new version after 2.5, the platform will become Android based. Right, so the development actually got quite a lot of difference from what we are doing now. Yeah, because like my team actually considering and doing the same thing. We when we started develop Pepper back in 2017, so we started with Choreograph. Okay, then we found like Choreograph is really very limited, and it's very hard to program for complex development for RoboCup. Then we start to look at the Nauchi API, which is we try to combine the API with ROS. So that is what my team is working on. But we found that actually when we work, we try to use ROS to develop Pepper, we actually face some difficulty, especially when the Nauchi API is actually not very friendly for ROS in some sense. Although I think like SoftBank, they have put a lot of effort try to create the ROS package that try to link between ROS and also Nauchi API and also the SDK. So I would like to know, like, how many percentage that you actually doing in your ROS framework, do you actually also try to work on the Python SDK? So which means, are you trying to do everything with ROS, or those that you can run on Python SDK, you will focus on Python SDK?
Okay, so basically we have done like you, the same way we have done, like, firstly test with Choreograph, then with the Python SDK, and we came up with the same solution, that it's not sufficient for our needs. And the other point that is very interesting with ROS is that there is a lot of packages that is already built and that we can use online. So it's very interesting in this kind of competition, because we have we are like pushing by the time. We have to improvise and implement very fast every modules. So this solution is very interesting, that we can try all the modules that we found online and choose the best one instead.
So far, ROS give you good resources in order for your development. That is what I guess, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So which means, but, like, from ROS you can get a lot of other function. Yes.
Yeah.
But as I have explained, in the ROS basic, there is some issue with the ROS package, because some specific things that is available with the Python SDK, we cannot do everything with the ROS package. So that's why we use, like, for the dialogue, we use the NaoQI dialogue part. So we use sometimes ROS and sometimes the Python SDK for the paper robot.
Yeah. All right. Yes. So I can totally understand what you're trying to do there. And I think it is quite common between your teams and also my team is working on. So we try to use the best what ROS can provide. And then those things that we can't really use ROS, we will use directly the Python SDK, right? The Nauchi Python
yes.
SDK. Yeah. So I guess that is what we are trying to do, and you will proceed with this direction. Okay, so why I try to discuss this is because, like, your team aim to participate in the RoboCup at home next year, right? The main
yes.
event, which is the SSTL.
Correct.
So I understand that, and because why I'm concerned about this is, like, I'm not sure the direction that eventually will SoftBank actually support, like, for us to actually working on Python base, because, like, they have gone the new version that gone to Android, which is that one is we can understand the logic is because that one is more for commercial use, commercial development, but for research and also academic, we try to use this Python, and we try to use a lot of ROS to cover all these things. So so hence I understand that your team is actually focused on this direction, and yeah, you feel comfortable to continue with this, which is good. Okay, right. So
yes, I can say we are trying to update one paper. It should be done this month. So we also are going to move to the Android part.
Okay.
for the robots, but it's just a try for now. We are. The idea is just to update one robot. We have four robots.
Yep.
And let's see. I think it will change everything. Everything will be in Java and.
Yeah. Yeah. So you will because you have four, so you are going to upgrade one to the Android version, right?
Mm.
Okay.
Just for testing.
So
let's see what's happened.
Yeah, because the upgrade will be, how to say, it's non-reversible. So once you are Android,
yeah,
Android.
Exactly, it's forever.
Yeah. So you have to really careful, because, like, there is actually quite a lot of discussion among the Pebble community about this, and we are actually considering, like, whether we should go towards the Android direction or stick with the ROS and also this Python base. Because like I'm not sure whether we can still use ROS once we move to Android. I think it will be quite complicated. I'm not sure how it can be done, but I think it'll be complicated. So which means you need to do everything, for example, like the navigation and everything with Android, which is you need to write everything, rewrite everything in Java, and they're actually using Kotlin or Kotlin, something like that.
I heard there is a version of ROS in Java, but I didn't try.
I don't think it's quite straightforward, because like now 90% of the ROS code is written in Python. okay right.
I see.
So this is one of the things that I observe and share with you. So I would like to know, like, because we are very concerned that this direction, whether we should continue with this, we want to know like the teams that eventually how this will go, because this direction is quite, I think it's your concern as well, because if eventually everyone move to Android, then we have to move to Android and
I guess we have no choice, because SoftBank said they will stop the old version, so very soon it will be not possible to move forward with the old version. This is what happened with now V4 and even V5. It's not possible for now to do anything with those robots, because SoftBank decided to stop everything. You cannot even repair your robot which are too old. So I guess we have no choice, we have to move to Android. But maybe we can stay like that for 1-2 years.
I see. All right. Okay. So that's one of the questions. But well, it's okay. So today our discussion will be still on ROS and still on Python and all these things. And another question that I would like to know, based on your presentation, is like, just now I saw like you actually connect the robot with Ethernet, right? The LAN cable. Do you find that the wireless is actually not very stable?
Yeah, we have several issues with this point. The first one was effectively that the Wi-Fi was not stable, but we have a second point that the Wi-Fi was not too strong to get a good communication between ROS. So, for example, when we need to retrieve the camera images, we need to get a very high speed and frame rate, and it was not possible with using Wi-Fi.
Okay, I see. Yeah, because like my team also realized the problem that when we're using Wi-Fi, the connection is not stable. We sometimes got disconnected. But just for your information, in RoboCup at home competition, they don't allow LAN cable. So actually have a lot of issue with Wi-Fi, and it seems like it's something that not able to solve.
Yeah,
for us.
We are aware about this problem. That's why we are now trying to make cross-compile all our code to put it on board the robot.
Also, which means so
also one of our goal was not to prepare ourselves immediately for the 2021 competition. It was to prepare ourselves for the 2020 education challenge, and to do this we preferred something which we would be certain that would work than something which would be on Wi-Fi, which would be completely uncertain. For example, as far as perception module is concerned, well, if you only have one image every 5 seconds, of course this won't be sufficient. We need to have like high quality image like as soon as we can, and on Wi-Fi that was not possible. So that's why we prefer using internet as well.
I see. All right. Yeah, so we understand, because like we face the same problem about the unstable wireless connection and the cable. So the cable actually helps, right, for your case? Helps a lot in terms of like, and do you do you feel like the sensor, because I'm not sure yours is in which version, is either 1.8a or 1.8 or something, like you are taking, are you using the stereo camera version, your paper. I'm not sure which one is your. Is it your camera will give you the depth image?
Yeah.
Feed?
Basically, we are using two different camera, the RGB camera, basic one, and the depth camera.
Okay, so you have the depth camera inside there. So which means the one that.
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken,
yeah, there
this
is
one
in the eye and one.
Yeah. Okay. So I think yours is very similar to me. And do you actually feel that the resolution is too low, or is it sufficient for your development?
Yeah, like I said in the presentation, the problem with the depth camera is that is located inside the eye of paper, and there is a lens in front of the depth camera. So when you retrieve the image from the depth camera, it is like not really the real image, you know. So we have to be aware of this error and take it to account in our code.
I see. All right. So are you actually develop the how to say the navigation package? I mean, you try to do the adaptation by yourself, or you're using some of the standard ROS package? I mean, like, not standard, but developed by other teams.
Yeah, no, we're using the standard ROS package, but without the using the depth camera. We only use the laser sensor because the error could be too difficult to handle.
Okay,
you know?
So I see. So because like in my team, we actually study various way to do the navigation, especially for the distant, I mean like the depth sensors data for the for the G mapping, and also for the AMCL for localization, and also for the SLAM.
Yeah, yeah.
And we found that the laser sensor down there is pretty much not really reliable.
In fact, we
are actually using the depth sensor or the RGBD sensor for our that together. So which means like we merge two data. So we use the one on top and also the one below. We use these two data for the navigation, in fact.
Yeah, but for the depth camera sensor, do you use it like this, or do you convert it in lasers data?
Okay, so there are a few ways, and we are using the standard depth to laser package in ROS.
Yeah, okay. We try it, but
it's not
it
good.
Was complicated. Yeah, we try it, this one.
Okay, so because like somehow it works for us, so we are using that. Because like one of our collaborators in Italy, they actually write their own. So they have their own package to do the conversion. So to get depth data and do the navigation. So I think like many people are actually working on this, and we have actually quite several ROS packages and also solution on the web that try to do this navigation. But so far, I think like the navigation by using ROS is still acceptable, but not really, how to say, accurate. I mean, it just do the job, but it's not so accurate. And SoftBank, if I'm not mistaken, they just they actually respond to us like not long ago that they said they can use the Android version have a full navigation solution that they just pushed out not long ago. So
I was in the webinar who they present this navigation program, and it was like a visual SLAM, so it's completely different that we are doing now, because they retrieve the information from the camera and they just process the camera as a 3D representation of the environment. So it's quite different, and I think it's more reliable for like being in dynamics of your environment, like when there is people moving around the robot. But for the RoboCup at home challenge, we have not the need to put this powerful tool. We can just rely on 2D basic SLAM.
Yes. So I'm not sure, because like I just saw the demo video. I haven't worked on it myself. I don't have an Android version paper to work on it, but it seems like it will take up a lot of computational, and I'm not sure whether do they actually have another powerful machine behind that running, or everything is running on board. If everything is running on board, I'm not sure how they make it work. But just now when I saw when I look at your slide, you actually presented like you have one computer and one server. So actually, how is your architecture? I mean, like you have the paper, and then you have another PC that connect by LAN, and you have another server. Is that what you mean?
Yeah. Maybe I will let Cedric explain it.
Okay.
Cedric Lebono, if you can.
Well, I can explain my part, which is a server, but I'll explain the manager. Well, it will have to be you. Mm-hmm. So the idea of using the server, well, it was mentioned earlier. It was originally, well, we tried to put everything on the same, on a single computer. However, obviously, because we have the manager, we have the computer vision aspect, which uses two programs, which are really intensive as far as GPU is concerned. Well, it was simply not possible to do anything about this. So we are forced to use two computers because our computers were simply not powerful enough to handle everything on a single one. So, which is why what we did was to connect a computer which has a manager to another computer which handles the server aspect using the internet connection. We're just talking. As a service, just communicating with the main computer using just HTTP requests. We're just sending, like, well, the manager is just sending requests such as, oh, can you search in this image if there is a person? Can you search in this image if a person is raising his hand? And we return, well, if we detected this or that, and also the image with all the detection so that it can be used with the navigation program.
Okay, so I roughly understand, but how that laptops and also server link, are they linked within a network or are they connected to the robot directly?
So the robot is connected to the computer directly with the paper is connected to the computer with a manager with an internet cable. And the computer with the manager is linked to the computer with the server with also an Ethernet cable.
Okay, all right. So I roughly know how you do it. But just for your information, I think like for our RoboCup at home, it allowed only one, if I'm not mistaken, external devices, which is you only can connect to one laptop wirelessly by using their network. And other thing, for example, like because many teams they are using like cloud computing, or for example, they are using Google API or anything on the cloud, you are allowed to do so, but you need to do it via the computer. So which means you only can allow to have one. That's why
our main problem was that we had, well, a computer, well, was fairly, well, we had fairly old computers, just to put this frankly, so it was not possible to do everything at once, but now we're planning to get a real good one. So fortunately if we're lucky enough, it will be possible to run everything on this single one, which would actually help a lot because we could just simply remove the HTTP connection. But as you can guess, well, to put things into the context, we couldn't really get another computer because of COVID. So this is why we're stuck with what we had for the RoboCup at Home Education Challenge, and we had to make do with what we had. We couldn't afford like to get a new computer in time and just program everything to make sure that it would work perfectly. So we had to, we just adapted with what we had.
Yeah, I totally understand what you are doing now, and I think it's possible that you try to combine the server and the laptop together. But just I would like to know, because just now you also said that in order for the robot to optimize its own operation, you might think of to shift some of the computational power, like you use the toolchain to make Pebble internal computer unit to run certain application, right? So that you don't need to transfer everything out to do the processing. So that is one thing, but I'm not sure how far it can go, because like the computing power within Pepper is actually not very high. So
This is indeed a problem for the computer vision aspect, because obviously we cannot use everything we used. The question becomes then, well, do we really need everything that we use for the atom challenge, the education challenge for the atom challenge 2021? We'll probably have to scrap a lot of things and use different approaches to solve our problems.
Yeah, which is true that it might come to the point that we actually cannot assume we have unlimited computing resources for this kind of development, and we actually need to optimize the computational requirement, especially if you put this into a scenario, for example, like how you want to do all this thing with your handphone. So instead of make your handphone with a lot of computing power, they actually have a lot of research efforts try to reduce or optimize the computational instead, right? They find out like you will have a motivation to think of algorithm how to optimize the image processing and so on, rather than feeding more and more computational power. So I guess that is another direction, but it is very clear that we need to have a quite, reliable computer as an external device for the paper, right? But the problem here is like we need to connect with the internet cable because of the latency and also the unstable wireless connection. So that might be something very tricky. I mean, we face a lot of problems during the competition, and in fact, If you ask other teams that joined in the previous RoboCup at home in the SSPL, I think there's one point that every one robot just not working because the connection just messed up.
Yeah, it happens. Fortunately, well, this is life. It happens.
Because something that I actually worry whether the organizer actually will force us to try to shift more of this computational into the robot itself, or try to do like the HSR, the DSPL way, which is you actually mount the external device on the robot itself. So which means like
exactly what's happened to the RoboCup soccer. At the beginning, we were able to use a PC, external PC. But now it's not loaded anymore. So I guess you are right. At the end, everything should be on board and that's it. We are in a transition time right now. So you can do a little bit externally, but at the end, I'm sure they will decide everything has to be on board and that's it.
Yeah, but for the time being, I think like I also appreciate like if you can feedback as a teams that participate in RoboCup at home next year to the organizer, that because currently for the HSR, they allow external device mount on the robot, but not for Pepper. So I'm actually thinking that we should allow Pepper to do so as well, but I'm not sure how you want to mount, for example, if you have a 17-inch Alienware, which is maybe like a 3 to 5 kg. So it's very hard to like mount on the Pepper body, but I think that is actually a practical way, at least for now or for next year.
We can add a backpack to now.
Yes. So it's like carry a backpack. Yes, correct. Because I think that is makes sense. And for the current moment, because like we can't really like try to optimize everything and push everything into the main PC in Pepper. So I think like having an external PC that on board, which means like on the robot body and connect with the LAN cable, I think that is what we need to ask. I mean, if you are given the chance, I will advise you, or not, I will share with you this information, like because next year I'm not sure like how much they will change the rule or they will update the rules or anything, but as a team, that because my team also will be joining for the SSPL, so I think our feedback to the OC, because I'm no longer the OC, so our feedback to the OC is very important to actually address this problem.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because like
Actually, we are part of the organization for next year.
Okay.
So we can make this suggestion.
Yes.
And let's see what's happened.
Yes. So
because it makes sense.
Yeah. So I actually would like to share this a few things that we need to really voice to the OC to the TC actually, because the TC are going to do the rules.
The rules.
Yeah. So for the TC, they have to heard that we need to have external device for Pepper as well, and also we need to somehow have a work away work about for the wireless connection, because Pepper wireless connection really not stable, and I really because we face a lot of problems this year. I mean last year we cannot connect to the robot, and or the robot work until halfway and the connection just we cannot connect back. Then we need to like restart the whole Pepper, and it wastes a lot of time. So that is something that maybe to feedback to you, so that we can, as a community within the at home, we can reflect this back to the TC and also OC. Right. Okay. So
We heard that in the last competition, you guys had a lot of troubles with Wi-Fi connection. So in Bordeaux, we put a lot of money on that. So society expert in Wi-Fi and stuff like that will be present only to make sure it will be stable. So I hope it will be okay.
Yeah. But I think for Pepper, I still suggest that if possible, we use LAN cable.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So that's one thing, because like I don't think they allow LAN cable, at least for now. Like the rules, they don't allow. Okay, so that's one thing. Okay, so let's I have some question on your architecture. I mean the manager and the thing. May I know like how you actually develop the manager? Are you using certain
Stage
package, for example, like the Smash package or the hierarchical thing to do the control or to do the manager? Because for your module, I understand like you package everything into the small module, but how you actually, do you actually use a ROS package to do the high level coordination between the packages? Or for example, like I'm not sure if you're using the Smash package to do this coordination or you actually write the manager by yourself?
We write the manager by ourselves. We didn't use any package because we want to have the total control of the output of every modules, and can have the control of the input of every function of if each package. So we built the entire manager, and we didn't use anything except some Python library.
I see. Okay. Right. But is it easier or not easy? I mean, like I'm not sure like how you write it. So is your architecture is like very easy to actually rearrange the module for a different task? For example, like when you switch between task one and task two, how complex or how easy using your architecture to redesign the different tasks, for example?
As I say, our manager isn't a state machine.
Okay.
We perform tasks sequentially. So we just ask for an action, like to listen for human or to move somewhere, asking it from the navigation modules. And then we are listening from a feedback to know if the action is performed or not. If not, and if a time is passed, we skip the motion and we go through the next step.
So we use only ROS to start the package, and we use ROS package only for the low part, so get the camera information or etc. The communication between module work only with Python.
Oh, okay. So that is not within the ROS, but you connect with Python. I see. I'm not sure. Do you publish this development or Yeah, do you publish this architecture or anything that on academic papers or anything?
So we are writing a document, a paper for ICRA conference.
Okay.
So hopefully we will be accepted.
Yeah, because like I would like to read your papers on how you actually
yeah.
design this. Yeah. The details.
Yeah, it's almost done, and we should submit at the end of the month, and yeah, hopefully it will be accepted, so
okay.
everybody can enjoy
yeah,
the
yeah.
details.
Yeah, I look forward to read this paper, but come to this point because like among all the teams that work on SSPL, I realize that many people are doing quite a very similar approach. So I'm actually like wondering if anyone actually tried to come up with an open source architecture that everyone can contribute back. But do you have the plan that you want to create an open source architecture or open source thing for this development?
That's a very nice question. I agree. We should have something common, at least for manager or stuff like that. In the RoboCup soccer, this is what we are doing. There is a famous team which is called Bioman, who publish its code every year. We should do that for the SSPL. And actually, in the RoboCup Atom Soccer, it's in the rules. That means if you want to compete, you have to publish your code. That's it. There is no choice. I have no idea for the SSPL, but I think it's a good thing. Because if we want to improve every year what's happened in the competition, we need to take advantage of what have been done, and if everybody can enjoy of that, from my point of view, it should be in the rules. If
yeah,
you participate
yeah.
you publish. That's it.
Yeah, I mean like it's a very nice effort for you to actually try to open source this thing and because I think like all the teams are trying to do something very similar. So we use the ROS package and we try to write a manager, or we use various kind of way to actually manage all this module to run together with in some sense. And I think like if let's say like you have a very nice architecture that you put open source, I think a community driven development will actually grow and benefit the Pepper user community to actually make it better, because like or else everyone is trying to reinvent the wheel and try to come up with
yeah.
this architecture and so on. But yeah, I really really like please and also look forward like
yeah.
eventually can see your architecture and try to use it on the Pepper as well. That will be very useful, and then so we can actually put our effort more on other things, for example like the interaction part, for example other things that we try to work on. But I can see like a lot of things that you're trying to do just now, and you demonstrated very nice demo just now, because like it seems very stable and not so much of noise that happened during the demonstration. I would like to know like how much actually how robust is this system, like for example like if you put a scale of 10, do you think your architecture and so on currently actually meet your own expectation, or do you think that we still need like so how you actually self assess your own architecture in terms of stability, in terms of robustness for the current moment?
Yeah, I think the global architecture is quite okay for our needs. The main issue was some modules that are not enough accurate, and if we want to have like very reliable solution, we need to be sure that each module will do exactly that we want. And that was a kind of pro issue that we encountered during this competition, is that some module fails, and if some module fail, it will fail all the rest.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the architecture is good for us, for our needs.
Okay, so one more question about the gesture. So just now you actually show a very big architecture. I mean, like you do the learning for the movement, right? I mean, you use certain techniques to learn the movement. I would like to know, like, why you want to do the learning when your movement is just like this. So are you actually plan that the learning can eventually learn more complex movement actually? For example, like you want Pepper to learn a dance step, for example. Something big.
So
yeah.
Yes, so I do that because I work on that. And so this part works with every movement you want. So for example, I do the Macarena dance with now robot, so you can do complex movements. The only issue with that is for the moment, it doesn't make a link with the perception part. So you need to put the object on the same position every time. But yeah, you can do complex movements also. I have some video on my webpage with this learning phase.
I see. Yeah, I will, because like one of my students are actually doing something very similar. So we actually try to make Pepper learn not by moving the arm, but by observation. So we record the human movement, and then we have the skeleton, which is we have the detection of the skeleton. We use like open pose or anything. So once you have the skeleton, you try to let Pepper learn the skeleton. Although like we have different anatomy, but we try to learn that different, so that Pepper can actually do something very similar like what it observed from humans. So that is one of the research work that currently one of my students is working. But for Pepper, it's always complicated to program the movement, because I can see like a lot of because Pepper is very nice like appearance. So for dancing is one of the very frequently used performance to demonstrate the beauty of the structure. But the pain is always like you need to do the programming of all the movement. So if let's say we have a open loop like a dancing, so basically we don't need any perception. We just need the Pepper to move in certain things. So that would be nice that we can actually like put in a video and the robot will learn how the human move. But you keep on stressing that you actually plan to incorporate with the perception, so that when you learn to grab something, you can actually make the system able to detect where is the object or where's the target for you to grab. And I just wonder like how you actually want to incorporate the perception with the development that you have shown over here. How you want to put these two together? Are you going to do
so,
things like a solver, like I don't know. Yeah.
So with the first part of what you say, so yes, I know that you can extract the human movement and try to make a link with the paper robot, but the main issue with that is human have more possibilities with the movement that the robots, and you have to create a link between the human joint and the paper joint, and sometimes human can do robots that no, sometimes a human do movement that the robot is not able to do. So you have to create a mapping between human and robot, and it's very complex to do. So that's why I don't use that. The second part was with the perception module. So the main idea I will try, but there is some possibilities to do. So I use the GMM and GMR algorithm. So if I save the movement with the hand position, you can move the Gaussian with the object position. So we can adapt the algorithm with the position of the object if you detect where you need to take the object in the trajectory part.
So which means in your GMM or GMR calculation, you have actually, you can define one additional parameters, as like for example the endpoint of the end effectors, and
yeah.
So you can put that so that when the learning, it can actually adapt to that data or that position as well.
Yeah, the position of the object and also the obstacle, because if you see an obstacle in the environment, you can adapt the Gaussian to the detected obstacle.
All right, so I guess, yeah. So I can see like you have a lot of development that have a lot more long-term plan, that a lot more development that you can do. So I actually look forward your development. So hopefully that next year during the event, we can see more development from your team. Yeah, it's really look forward. So it's very nice that today, like you share a lot of all this information to us, and hopefully this video will be very useful for other teams or even new teams that would like to know how to program or develop Pepper for service robot development. So I think this will be very useful, because like you guys have presented a very overall structures that cover a lot of small details that people actually look into, and you have cover from navigation, from the arm, from the movement, from the speech, and from the perceptions and everything in one package. So that will be very useful for a lot of people, I mean, eventually. Right, so as a last, before I proceed with the conclusion to conclude this session, do you have any things that you can tell for people that, okay, so to make things simple, what do you think like develop this with a Pepper platform have helped you, or actually why this thing will be, how to say, why your development is using Pepper helpful for your development, or helpful in what sense that you can achieve certain tasks, and do you have any words for beginner teams? For example, like now we have a new team that want to join at home. So they are considering whether they go to the Pepper League or they go to the Toyota League, or they want to develop their own robot. So do you have any things that you want to share, that what is the advantage of using the Pepper platform? That's the first thing. And second thing is, do you have any suggestion or any advice for the new team to start the development like what you have done?
Yeah, I think the most interesting point using Pepper is that it's a stable platform. You have all the resources that you need. You can call SoftBank if you have any issues and stuff like that. And if you are a beginner team, you can start by using Choreograph or using Python SDK API that is, for instance, quite good. And after, if you want to go further and build like a big application, you can try to learn ROS and ask to the ROS community and find all the resources that you want online, because it's one of the most interesting thing with ROS is that you can find a lot of tutorials, and it's quite easy to learn ROS and to implement it on paper, because there is also tutorials how to implement ROS on paper, how to work with ROS and paper and NowQE. And this is, for me, not hard to understand.
Yeah. Any more from the rest of the member? So your experience, like, I think this is the first time, right, you join RoboCup at home.
Yeah,
again.
And if I want to share a little bit my experience, it was very interesting for us to work in this competition, because we work in limited time. So we are not searching to implement the best solution, but to implement a fast and easy to use solution that can make the job anyway, anytime in our final scenario. That is, for me, the most interesting part working on this kind of competition.
I see. So actually, as on behalf of the organizer of RoboCup at Home Education, I actually still look forward that your teams can join our event next year, because we will actually have a pepper event in RoboCup at Home Education in Bordeaux as well. Although I know like your target is for the at home, which is, yes, that's supposed to be, you're supposed to go there. But also, if let's say you have any new members or any junior members that you are bringing along, I welcome you to join the RoboCup at Home Education standard platform. we call it standard platform. So we have the open platform and the standard platform, in which is like you just join in the at home, the online challenge 2020. But for next year, currently what we're planning, we will collaborate with SoftBank to do something very similar, like at home SSPL within the at home education framework. Yeah, so hopefully if you have any new members or you are forming junior members in your team, I welcome your teams to join for the at home education challenge as well, for the standard platform division. Right.
Okay, we will. We have a lot of students in the school, so okay, we can give the information.
yeah, sure. So yeah, so I think like we already, because like it's supposed to happen this year, but somehow everything moved to next year, so we can't do it. But without wasting time, like wait for another year, so we actually initiated the online challenge, which is something of we don't expect to do that this year, but I think it's a good development. So we have the online challenge, edition of at home education challenge, but next year we will do something physical, hopefully in Bordeaux, along with the at home SSPL. So hopefully, like, yeah, you can promote this for your new members, and I look forward your team to join us as well. Right, so thank you very much, and let me go to our conclusion for today. So let me conclude. Okay, so hope it will be displayed. Right. Okay, so thank you very much for the very interesting presentation. So I really appreciate you guys to tell us a lot details on your development, sharing your knowledge and also your experience. And I think this content, this presentation and whatever that you have just presented or share will be a very valuable resources for new team, especially in our community, because like our community is, we try to encourage more new teams, more new people and even general public to join this kind of development. So your materials that you presented today will be very helpful for them. I believe that because personally me myself, I feel that all your resources that you presented today is very, how to say, we can actually refer a lot of things, and hopefully like in future we can actually correspond and have more discussion after this. Right, so thanks RoboBreizh, and congratulations again for your winning on the at home challenge, online challenge 2020, and hopefully next year you can achieve more in Bordeaux, the event. So as I said just now, welcome you to join the education challenge standard platform division as well. Right, so
thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot. So before I close this session, so I would like to encourage more people to share our resources. So I believe like later on, please send your slide to me so that I can put it on the website together with the video. So I will put up the videos and also the slides that you presented. And hopefully like if you have any information that you wish to share, for example, like your paper in ICRA or any other papers that you have that published that would like to share with, I will put together the link down there. And yeah, I look forward like if you become, I mean like eventually you put this project as open source. Just one more information for you, like in RoboCup at home, although we don't force, not to say, we don't mandatory all the teams to open source their development, but they have an open source award.
Okay.
Okay.
Nice to know.
Right. So in RoboCup at home, so they have this.
We would like to thank you for this organization.
I
know it's time consuming and it's very well organized, so thank you so much for that.
Welcome. I mean, like, we actually, I would like to thank you all for the participation and also bringing very high quality entry to us as well, so that everyone can see like very nice performance that you have done. Okay, so hopefully all this information and also resources, we can share it. So on the screen, we have all the links. So our website, our Facebook page, remember to go there, like us, and also join our Facebook group. And then we'll try to have the open source, so we have all the teaching materials, including Pepper. So we actually run Pepper 2.9 and also 2.5 classes, online classes before this, and all the example, and for example, like the entry level, how to make the Pepper speak, how to make the Pepper move, how to make the Pepper perceive something. So all the basic thing, we actually have the teaching materials, which is on the online classroom, and also all the source code for the example are available on GitHub, right? So GitHub is over there. So for the rest of you, for those that watching this video, feel free to contact us. You can write to our organizing committee member, Valder, OC at robocup@homeeducation.org, email. Right, so this, I'm very happy because like today is the last session for our this special online challenge 2020 invited lecture series. So it's a very nice two months time to actually host some six of this team to share their experience for the previous online challenge 2020. But hopefully we can have more of this sharing session online after this. We are still in planning, so we will make the announcement later on. But I put the URL here, I mean like the QR code, you can go to the page for any of you that are interested to look at the video again, and also to access, for example, the slides, and also like some of the team, they actually share some source code, some example. All the links are available on our website. Right. So with that, I would like to say thanks to Team RoboBreizh. And really nice today for this series session, and hopefully like we will see again very soon. And please keep in touch, and also we would like to know more about your development after this. Okay,
thank you so much.
Thank you. Right, so with that, I would like to close this session, and thank you very much. Right.
Okay,
see you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. See you.
Bye-bye, everybody.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.